Several weeks ago, we began our study of weather and climate. In Chapter 3 of the textbook, we learned the four elements of weather and climate. You should be able to easily list them from memory. Since then, we have covered all four elements. We covered temperature in weeks 6 and 7, when we covered Chapter 4 material. We covered pressure and wind in week 8, when we covered Chapter 5 material. And we covered atmospheric moisture last week in week 9 when we covered Chapter 6 material. Throughout our study, we have considered the factors that control weather and climate as well. You should be able to list all 7 controls of weather and climate from memory and give examples of how they impact one or more of the four elements. Also in Chapter 3, we distinguished the difference between weather and climate. You should be able to easily define both terms and note how they are similar and how they are different. Did you define the terms? Define them now for yourself. All right, let's get started. But before moving on, you should pause the video and answer these four questions. If you answer them in writing in some sort of document that you can keep for yourself, that's all the better. Our primary goal in this lesson is to learn the different climate types and to learn how the modified Köppen classification system works. Notably, a few of our weekly objectives deal with climate change. We studied that a bit in Chapter 4, and the textbook covers it very thoroughly. Thus, I've chosen to focus the lesson here on describing climate types and climate classification. In the past, I found students had a hard time with the Chapter 8 reading, maps, and climagraphs. Thus, I've used this lesson to highlight some of the most important points about each climate type, and I also want to walk you through the maps and climagraphs. Take your time going through the video clips, take notes, study the climagraphs, the maps, and the photos, and then, of course, review. So first, why should we learn to classify climates? Well, first, climate classification is a very useful learning tool. It will force us to put together and use the concepts that we have covered over the last several weeks. Additionally, climate classification makes it easier to compare regions around the world. If I asked you right now to describe the climates of Beijing, China, Hamburg, Germany, and Lagos, Nigeria, you probably wouldn't know where to start. After this week's lesson, you should be able to make some sophisticated, educated guesses about climates of particular locations, simply by looking at a map. Further, as impacts of climate change become more evident around the world, our knowledge of climate and climate classification can help make predictions about impacts of climate change. In the late 1800s and early 1900s, there were many climatologists working on developing appropriate and useful climate classification systems. By far the most notable individual was Russian-born German climatologist Vladimir Köppen. Köppen's system is the basis for most modern climate classification systems, including the modified Köppen system used in our textbook. Köppen's system is robust, yet still fairly simple. In fact, the Köppen system relies on only two types of climate data, the average annual and average monthly precipitation, and the average annual and average monthly temperature. If you have that data for a particular weather station, you can classify the climate. And since that data is readily available, this system works well around the globe. The modified Köppen system that we're going to be using includes 5 major climate groups, A, B, C, D, and E, and also an additional climate group called the Highland climate. You should memorize these 6 climate groups. It's not that hard, especially as the letters more or less represent latitude. Let's look at them again. I highly encourage you to take out a piece of paper and take some quick notes on each of these six major climate groups. We're going to see that these first five are generally, but not always, related to latitude. And the sixth just accounts for elevation. All right, first, A climates are tropical humid climates. The name says a lot. They're near the equator, in the tropics, and it's warm and wet. It's wet because the equatorial region is a low pressure zone, right? The ITCZ. So the air is rising, and the warm, moist air rises, it cools and forms clouds and rain. So A climates are tropical and humid, near the equator and wet. Next are B climates. The B climates are dry climates, and they tend to be near 30 degrees north and south. You'll remember that at 30 degrees north and south, we have the subtropical high. In a high pressure cell, the air is descending. Descending air means there's no clouds or rain because you need rising air to form clouds. Since there's no clouds or rain, right around 30 degrees is where we have many of the world's deserts. So our B climates, our dry climates, tend to be near 30 degrees, though they aren't all near 30 degrees. Next, moving up to our mild mid-latitude and severe mid-latitude climates. Both these two climates are in the mid-latitudes, as the name suggests. The C climates, the mild mid-latitude climates, tend to be between 30 and 60 degrees latitude, north and south, and they're often, but not always, coastal, given them the more mild temperature profiles. On the other hand, our severe mid-latitude climates are still in the mid-latitudes, but they're a little bit more poleward, perhaps up near 60 degrees or even a little higher, and or they might be in the interiors of the continents. And you'll remember that in the interiors of the continents, we get colder winters and hotter summers. Next are polar climates. As the name suggests, they tend to be near the poles, near 90 degrees north and near 90 degrees south. As you might imagine, these are cold places. Lastly, our highland climates. These are controlled by elevation and can be found at any latitude. For instance, a high mountain region near the equator you might think would be an A climate, but because of the high mountains, it's much colder and you end up having what we call a highland climate. We're not going to use highland climate too much in our discussions, but just know that they exist. All right, those are our six major climate groups, and you definitely should memorize their names and letters, and remember that it often has a relationship to latitude. All right, let's see what the actual distribution looks like on a map. You can see the rough relationship to latitude when you see the green A climates near the equator. Next, some B climates here. C climates in the mid-latitudes. And D climates even more poleward or in the interiors. And then lastly, our E climates in the poleward regions. But we have a lot more to learn. Before we move on, though, pause the video and see if you can answer these questions for yourself. Consider writing some of the answers down. Let's take another look at this map. You'll notice that there are A climates, B climates, C climates, D climates, E climates, and highland climates. But actually, the actual climate types shown on the map don't just have one letter. Most have three, and some have two letters associated with them. So let's explore that. Each major climate group is broken down into different climate types. Descriptive names are given to each climate type, and letter codes are used to represent specific precipitation and temperature values for each climate type. The system uses a letter code system with three letters. We see the first letter of each climate group up here, but then we see the final climate codes that we're going to end up with generally have three letters, although some have two. I realize this looks a little bit overwhelming just looking at it from here, but you'll get the hang of it. So the first letter of the modified Köppen system we're going to be using designates a major climate group. And as we've already discussed, it's roughly related to latitude. Another thing to note is that we always use capital letters for the first letter. The second letter generally refers to precipitation patterns. So it has to do with the amount and timing of the rainfall. And generally the second letter is written in lowercase, though there are a few exceptions that we're going to note later. For now, let's look at these four letters. F stands for feucht, which is the German word for wet. Yeah, I know, you didn't know you were going to learn German in this class, but there you go. So these are the wet climates, wet year-round. M stands for monsoon, so we know they have those incredibly huge summer rainfalls. W is winter dry season, and S is a summer dry season. So the second letter stands for the precipitation pattern. And remember, we generally use lowercase for the second letter. So the first letter was related to latitude. The second letter is related to precipitation. So the third letter is related to temperature, specifically usually the summer temperatures, though there's some exceptions to that. We always write the third letter in lowercase. And there'll be some other codes we use as well, but let's take a look at these. These are the most common ones that we use for the third letter. A, B, C, and D. Pretty easy to understand. A is hot, B is warm, C is cool, and D is cold. And again, that generally stands for the summer temperatures. These letter codes may seem complicated at first, but once you get the hang of it, it's pretty straightforward and even kind of fun to use. Appendix 5 in your textbook defines all the letter codes, and Table 8.1 in your textbook shows the whole system as well. You'll likely end up referring back to this table. It's a good one to bookmark. All right, let's check out that beautiful map again. For now, perhaps just focus in on the influence of latitude on the first letter on the major climate groups. You'll notice it's not perfect, but there is some general relationship to latitude often. Find some of the A climates, the B climates, the C climates, and the D and E climates as well. Pause the video and check it out. You'll also want to pause the video to quickly answer these four questions. If there's something you can't answer here, you'll want to go back and review it before moving on.